Hello learners, welcome to NIOS Studio. I am Dr. Sona Hoja, Associate Professor, and we'll talk about continuous and comprehensive assessment in mathematics. And in this topic, we will try to address these questions. What is continuous and comprehensive assessment? Why we should talk about continuous and comprehensive assessment? And then finally, how can continuous and comprehensive assessment be implemented especially for mathematics learning? So let's see the first question. What is continuous and comprehensive assessment? As you can see, it has two terms, continuous and comprehensive. So when we say continuous, what do we mean? It means the regularity of the assessment. Assessment has to take place at regular intervals. The student should get feedback at regular intervals and not only at the end of the course. If student gets feedback at the end of the course, then there is no opportunity for him to improve and he has to repeat the entire year to learn all the concepts again, which is very demotivating. So if you assess him regularly on daily basis, then he can get the feedback on his learning and can improve on the areas which he has not learned. So regularity of assessment is the continuous. Then diagnosis of the learning gaps, that is, in all the concepts he is supposed to learn by his grade level when he finishes, then where are the learning gaps? Which concepts he has not learned? So at every interval, he gets to know that this is the area where I require remediation. So continuous assessment, that is regular assessment, leads to identification of the learning gaps which are there in the learner. Then this in turn helps us to identify the corrective measures and use it to improve his performance, followed by retesting and then re-providing the corrective measures if required, thus giving feedback to both students and teachers. This is the continuity of the assessment. And so what does it mean when we say that assessment has to be comprehensive? So when we say assessment has to be comprehensive, it means that not only scholastic, but in co-scholastic activities also, the learner's assessment has to take place. That is, when we teach in the classroom, in different tests, when he applies the concepts, in his daily life, in his behavior, in his values, all these areas have to be tested. So it is not only the one domain or one aspect that makes the learning, the assessment complete, but all the aspects, different aspects of scholastic and co-scholastic experiences that make the assessment comprehensive. Then the another dimension of comprehensiveness is the variety of tools and techniques. Variety of tools and techniques enables the assessment of different learning experiences. Then all the domains, that is not only his intellect, but his affective domain, that is the change in his behavior, in his attitude, in his value system, and psychomotor domain, that is the use of the limbs. How does he use his sensory motor skills to apply mathematics or to learn mathematics? And then whether all the learning objectives are covered in the hierarchy from knowledge to evaluation. So this makes the assessment continuous and comprehensive. Now let's see, when we say scholastic domain, then what we should cover? Knowledge, that is recall, reproduce, the ability to recall the concepts, to reproduce the formula or the image of mathematics or the symbols, understanding of the concepts, comprehension and application in day-to-day life, analysis of the concepts so that they can apply, and then evaluation whether they are doing right or wrong, the steps. So in like mathematics, you remember you had to solve the problems and then validate the problems. So that is kind of evaluation, you're evaluating your own learning. So scholastic domain is said to be complete when it all the learning objectives, right from knowledge to evaluation, are assessed in the mathematics learning. Then at the topmost is the creation. That is, he is able to create the duplicate in the real life situation of the concepts of mathematics that he has learned. And this is the highest objective in the hierarchy. Then in co-scholastic domain, what aspects are to be covered in continuous and comprehensive assessment? One is the values developed through mathematics. It is believed that different values are developed through mathematics. One is disciplinary value. As the student solves the problem, they move logically from first step to another step to next step, giving reason for each step. And this develops the value of discipline. Then utilitarian value is developed through the application aspect of mathematics. Similarly, there are other values which are developed when a learner learns mathematics. Now, continuous and comprehensive assessment should measure whether these values are developed or not, then whether the attitude towards the mathematics of the student has changed, if it is negative, and if it is positive, then whether it is strengthened through the learning or not. Then his communication skills, the way he communicates, uses mathematical expressions in his communication, and the life skills. Maths not only has the theoretical aspect, but also has many aspects related to life skills. As in maths, they say that you can solve every problem using some or the other formula or concept. So this, when transferred to life, they say, as in maths, every problem has solution, so in life, every problem has solution. So this was just one example that mathematics learning can be transferred to life skills, and these also should be assessed while covering the core scholastic domain. Then in the assessment of core scholastic domain, the question is how we can do it. So there can be creative activities like preparation of models or teaching learning materials where their psychomotor domain is also tested along with their application behavior. Then field trips and projects. You can give them certain projects, like when they are learning the concepts of banking, they can go to bank and collect different types of checks and understand the process of banking. For profit and loss, they can prepare the budget for an event and see how much amount was input to the entire event and what is the outcome of it. So what is the difference? So the concept of profit and loss can be transferred, and they can do it through projects. Likewise, many other mathematics topics can be tested through projects. And then there can be literary activities like debates, elocution, essay writing, and quizzes. These co-scholastic domains can be assessed through the activities of mathematics club. As you must have heard about other club activities, club is nothing but, say, gathering of people who have same objective. So mathematics club is also a group of, it can also be a group of students who have the common objective of using mathematics in daily life or in various domains. And these activities of the mathematics club enable us to assess the co-scholastic domains of the learner of mathematics learning. Now, learners, why comprehensive continuous assessment? Why not the traditional assessment? What is the objective of continuous and comprehensive assessment? So the objective is to develop higher order skills and de-emphasize rote learning. Imagine, for the entire year, I teach you different concepts of mathematics, and at the end of the year, I assess your learning. What will happen? You will try to cram all the formula and try to reproduce in the exam, because you cannot consolidate, assimilate all the learning at last time, which is the periodic evaluation. So to de-emphasize this rote learning and to develop higher order skills, CCA is must. we have seen that CCA involves both scholastic and co-scholastic domains, whereas the traditional periodic assessment involves only written kind of tests, which has emphasis only on the crammed material. So in order to avoid this and in order to assess all the different aspects of the learner, CCA, continuous and comprehensive assessment. Then the another objective of continuous and comprehensive assessment is to ensure the development of all three human domains, that is cognitive domain. We assess different abilities through learning objectives. Right now we discussed the learning hierarchy of the learning objectives, whether it is developed or not. Then development of psychomotor domains as he handles the mathematical objects or models or 3D shapes. And the affective skills, like we talked about the values, those are developed using mathematics, his disposition, his attitude. So CCA ensures the development of all the three domains rather than the lopsided development. Hence CCA. Then continuous and comprehensive assessment also makes the process of teaching learning a learner-centered activity. We have seen what is a learner-centered activity, where learner is active and continuously engaged in the process of learning. So to make this teaching learning a process where the student is the center of this process and all the activities are designed according to him, CCA is must. Now, CCA also gives feedback to the teachers when and how teachers should improve the instructional strategies which she has designed for mathematics learning. For which kind of learners, what kind of strategies should be evolved? Which strategies work and which do not at different stages of learning? This can be known if continuously teacher assesses students' performance at each level of learning. That is at small steps. Each step gives the feedback and then there is the corrective action. So in order to improve the instructional strategies, continuous and comprehensive assessment, then to diagnose the learner's weaknesses and provide remedial teaching through formative assessment. That is, when for each concept we are assessing, then we can identify exactly which is the area where student requires remediation and which strategy would work for him. Also, to include not only the formative but also the summative assessments, the objective of which is promotion to the next grade and giving the overall review of what student has done. So CCA covers both the formative and summative assessment, which the traditional approach does not cover, which assesses only summative performance of the student. Then, what are the formative patterns? So when we say student should be continuously evaluated, then what are the examples and what are the tools through which we can assess what can be the patterns? So let's see what is the formative pattern of this. So one is you can assess student weekly and monthly. So rather than at the end of the course, every month or every week, you can design assessment. What can be the form of the assessment? It can be class assignments. So at the end of the week, whatever student has learned, you can assess it and it is very practical. It does not take much. It may take just 10 minutes. This is researched as well. So at the end of the week, at the beginning of the class, for 10 minutes, you assign time for the class assignment and assess what is the weekly performance of the learner. Similarly, you can have seminar and group discussions monthly or fortnightly with different groups. So student presents the concepts and its application and the comprehension of the concepts and can discuss these concepts with his peers, and this can be done fortnightly. Then you can have unit tests monthly. So this is the frequency of CCA. One is we assess through unit tests monthly. Fortnightly, we can assess through seminar and group discussions. And weekly, we can assess through class assignments. Then also to increase the frequency. not only weekly but daily you can evaluate the learner. Now, how daily evaluation is possible? That is, at the end of the lesson, you can ask recapitulatory questions. So, instead of summarizing yourself, ask the student the summary. Make them revise. What did they learn today? Make them discuss. So, this can be the assessment of the lesson at the end of the day. Give them home assignments where whatever concepts you have taught, make them understand those concepts, comprehend, and let it reflect through the evaluation daily. So, not only weekly or monthly, but daily also you can evaluate the learner at the end of the lesson or in the home assignments or even during the lesson by observing his performance or interaction in the classroom when you are asking introductory or developmentary questions, that is in the classroom. So, when introductory questions you are asking, you are trying to connect the previous knowledge of the learner with the new knowledge. So, it's known to unknown. So, whatever student has learned in the previous class, has he understood it? Has he absorbed it? It can be assessed in the next class. So, rather than just starting your class by saying, students, we would learn about this today, try to relate it to their previous knowledge. Ask the questions related to topic which they have learned in their previous class. This would assess whether they were able to assimilate what they have learned or not. Then also during developmentary questions, you can assess. So, students, you can see that formative patterns does not only exist in theory, but it can actually be implemented. So, CCA can be implemented in the formative pattern, and this is the example of it. That is through weekly, monthly, at the end of the lesson and in classroom. And there are institutions who have adopted these models and have been successful in identifying the weaknesses of the learners at regular intervals, as we said, evaluatory questions also. And in the summative patterns, you can ask long answer questions, short answer questions, and objective type questions. In the long answer questions, you can assess many objectives at a time, like whether the student is able to recall the formula, use the formula for the right concept, solve the problem logically, display the steps logically with the cohesion, give the logic for each step, is able to communicate the mathematical expressions or symbols, is able to draw the figures. So, when you want to assess many objectives at a time through a long problem, then you can give them long answer questions, then short answer questions like define the objectives, classify, identify, construct, or draw. Some students are not able to solve long problems. So, short problems gives them the reinforcement that they can still perform something when they do it in small steps. And actually, the compilation of short answer is the long answer, but it actually gives them the variety and it covers different types of students and students of different potentialities. So, it is inclusive. And the last one is objective type of questions, which most of the students enjoy doing it because it just gives the quick answer to the question. Now, there can be different types of objective type of questions. Let's see, quizzes, wherein they have to answer in one word, puzzles, wherein they just solve or perform, these can be performance based, analogies, wherein they relate one concept to the other concept. For example, we say 4 is to 2 dash 8 is to dash. That means he has to find out the relationship between 4 is to 2 and then reply for 8 is to dash. That means 4 is the double of 2, and similarly when he says 8 is to dash, that means he has to write down the number of which the double is 8. And these are called analogies, that is, they identify the relationship between the two concepts and based on that relationship, they try to answer other questions. And this can be done in one word, but it assesses their mathematical reasoning. Then construct type of questions, wherein we use fill in the blanks. And student does not have the options or the prompt, but the fill in the blank itself is the prompt. That is, they have the sentence, but a word is missing out of it. You can also make them define using construct type of questions. So the situation where the cost price is greater than selling price is known as dash. This is the construct type of questions wherein student has to construct the answer. Then we have matched the following questions wherein a set of concepts are given in one set and set of concepts are given in another, and student has to match these. For example, we say 8 by 4 and then we say 1 and then we say 2.1, and the other side we have real, we say fractions, we say integers. So student can match the concepts, like which is the example of real number, which is the example of decimal number, which is the example of integers. So this is the match the following type of questions. Then they can have true and false type of questions where we can assess whether student is able to judge the statement of mathematics is correct or not. And then we have classification type of questions wherein we give them lot of exemplars and non-exemplars mixed together, and then they have to classify the two categories. Or you can give more than two categories and then they have to classify. So this tests their ability to classify. And then identification, you give some examples wherein they have to just identify the situations or identify the symbols or identify the concepts. Then multiple choice type of questions, which are the favorite among students. That is, you ask a question or give a statement, then give four alternatives or perhaps three alternatives or five alternatives. And these alternatives have to be very close, and student has to select one of the alternatives which best suits to the statement given. So these are different types of objective questions. So in the summative patterns, you should use either long answer, short answer and objective, or rather the combination of all. So as we said, CCA addresses different domains and different learning abilities. Some students are good at performing certain things and others at it other. So every student should get opportunity to be assessed and to be reinforced while learning. So you should use all the three types of questions in summative patterns. Now students, time for assessment of yours. Try to answer these questions if you have understood today's discussion. That is, why continuous and comprehensive assessment should be implemented to assess mathematics learning. Try to differentiate it with the traditional methods of assessment. Why we should have CCA instead of traditional assessment. Discuss the dimensions of continuous and comprehensive assessment. We have discussed various dimensions, that is co-scholastic, scholastic dimensions, and in each dimension which are the different activities that they can perform. So discuss these with the example. And then how a student can benefit out of continuous and comprehensive assessment. What are the advantages of continuous and comprehensive assessment over the traditional assessment? Why in the first place itself we should implement continuous and comprehensive assessment? What are its merits? Discuss. Thank you.